Well, welcome back, Russell Graycoast of the Real Estate Guys Radio Show, here with my good friend and super syndicator, David Zook. Hey, Dave.
Hey, Russ. How are you?
I am excited to talk with you, my friend. I obviously followed your career because I think we take a little bit of credit for helping launch it. You, of course, were a successful businessman when we met you, but you knew nothing about syndication and really not a lot about real estate. And you came in with a big tax problem. So before we get into the weeds of how you help other people solve their tax problems, just tell everybody a little bit about your background and how what you're doing today and how you got there.
Yeah, so I grew up in the modular building space. My dad is very successful and had bought a modular building business the year I was born. So I grew up in that business. And as I was growing up and became involved in the business, I saw him do real estate and I wasn't interested, you know, in managing, self-managing single family homes and all that, like I saw him do. Instead I started investing in businesses, and many of them, a couple of them were in the modular building business space. And so got to the point where I built these businesses, got myself into a situation where I was paying around $500,000 in tax a year. And I knew there was a better way, but I didn't know how. So I got into, and that's when I got into your world. And I really got into your world by hunting down Robert Kiyosaki and his team, which led me to the Summit at Sea. And, you know, back then I was paying the highest tax rate. And today, over the last probably decade, 8-10 years, I've paid somewhere in between 0 and 3% tax rate. And so that's just a whole lot more fun than paying a 37% to 40% tax rate.
Yeah. And then you came into our syndication class because you realized, hey, I'm pretty good at this investing thing. And we said, hey, if you're a good investor, you know, share those skills with other people and raise money. And you've gone on to raise, as of now, I think over $200 million, right?
Approaching $250 million.
Yeah, that's just so amazing. So, you know, we tell people all the time, hey, take the syndication training. It, you know, it works and it does. And you're not the only one. We've got another guy that came through the program who's also raised over $200 million, and many, many people that have raised 10, 15, 20 million. So that part's exciting. But you took a unique angle. You went after people that had the same problem you had, and you branded yourself as a tax strategist. Now, to be clear, not a CPA, not a tax advisor, right? But a tax strategist. It's like kind of the way I do financial strategy. So what is it you do for people and what are we going to talk about today?
Well, you're right. And I'm not a CPA, but I actually counsel with quite a few CPAs. And I got to the point, you taught me this a long time ago, was how to influence the influencer. Yeah. And today I get a lot of CPAs calling me about different asset classes, about clients that they have. We sit down and have, you know, kind of a strategy session about their clients. So now I'm kind of working that model that you taught me about influencing the influencers. So really, when you help wealthy people solve a serious problem that they have, and it's surprising to me how many people run really good businesses and make a ton of money, but they don't understand the tax law. So oftentimes I'm coming to them with not just an asset class that'll help them get wealthier, that'll give them an extra cash flow stream, but I'm diving deeper and helping them get to the point where they can, you know, reduce their tax liability, cut tax brackets, and really getting into the weeds on that side.
Yeah. Now, the important thing about that is that we never let the tax tail wag the investment dog, right? If the only reason your deal makes sense is because of the tax breaks, or you're losing real money in the real world in order to get a tax break against something else that's working, I don't think anybody's excited about that kind of an investment. But when you can find an investment, of course, real estate is right at the top of the heap, that goes down in value on paper for taxable purposes, but goes up in value in the real world for real wealth purposes and produces cash flow, that's pretty impressive. But real estate's not the only thing that worked that way. That's how you started. But you found this crazy little niche that kind of like real estate, because it's a piece of equipment that sits on a very, very small piece of real estate, but cash flows like crazy. And because the asset is primarily a piece of equipment, you get these giant tax breaks. And what we're talking about are automated teller machines, ATMs. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, you're right. And at its core, it is a real estate play. You're taking a 3-foot by 3-foot piece of highly desirable real estate. And my argument would be your margin on that piece of real estate is probably greater than just about anything in the United States, or maybe in the world. So it is a real estate play, and we're finding these portfolios. And normally in the ATM space, you have two players. You have the mom and pop operator that's running around, you know, servicing restaurants and bars, and then you've got the institutional operators. So what we do is we're the only one in our space that I know of that kind of operates as a hybrid between the two. So we're playing in the institutional space. We go out there and we're taking down large portfolios, could be $5, $10, $20 million portfolios. And we're out there playing with the big boys, the Cardtronics of the world. And we're taking down these large portfolios and we're bringing them back down to Main Street to regular investors. We're chopping them up in bite-sized pieces. And it's really the only way that that investor will ever get an opportunity to invest in institutional grade portfolios, institutional grade locations like that, because you can't go into, let's say, a 7-Eleven and say, hey, I would like to put an ATM machine in your store. No, you got to take 500 locations. So you're dealing with a premium location, and you're taking down a large portfolio, and then we're chopping them up in bite-sized pieces for regular investors to come in and invest in those. Right now, we have a portfolio available that is offering bonus depreciation. That's something that I hadn't been able to talk about previously because it was always a 506B. We kept it in kind of in our close group of investors and friends and family, but we did open it up now. It's a 506C, and we can offer that to investors and offer 100% bonus depreciation. But you're right, it has to start with the investment. You gotta like the investment. The investment has to make sense. And then if it does and you pair it up with bonus depreciation, it can move the needle.
Yeah, so you threw out a little bit of jargon there. I wanna make sure nobody's left behind. First of all, of course, we're talking about ATMs, which is great, but you're not actually selling individual ATMs. You're buying a portfolio of ATMs and putting them inside of a fund or an LLC, if you will, that owns them. And then you're offering to accredited investors, because it's a 506C, that's just a exemption in the law that allows you to make private placement offerings as opposed to public registration to individual investors. And so they buy into this pool, which you own, the fund owns, and you operate for them. You take a small management fee, maybe some profit sharing, and then you give to them the bulk of the cash flow and the tax breaks. Is that kind of the gist of it?
It is. It's set up on a sort of on a preferred return basis, where they get a fixed return, and their return is based on the portfolio return. So they could have their ATM machines that they've got, you know, a bill, sale, and a serial number for. But let's say they're in New York City, and this whole city gets locked down. Well, they also got exposure to, you know, a portfolio of Walgreens in Florida. So they're diversifying their risk because it's not just based on their income. It's not just based on their ATMs. They're based on several hundred ATMs in the portfolio.
Yeah. So in other words, if you were an individual investor and said, hey, I'm going to get in this game, and you play at the mom and pop level, you might own a half a dozen machines and they're all located in the same city or maybe even in the same mall or wherever it is you have them. And then all of a sudden something comes along and happens in that geography and you have nobody using your machines and now you have no cash flow. Whereas if you're part of a much, much, much bigger portfolio, you're diversified over more machines, more different places. And if that portfolio is properly constructed, and I'm guessing that's part of what you do, then all the money kind of goes into a pool and everybody shares equally. And that's like kind of a mutual, kind of the way mutual insurance used to work. Everybody would pay a little bit of premium in. If something happened, the farmer's house burns down, they would pull from the pool and build the house. In this case, if everybody's kind of sharing the income, obviously we hope that all the machines are active and working and generating income, and the greater percentage of those, like an apartment building, that are rented and paying, the better. But you're always going to have a few that are offline. And if that happens to be yours, it's 100% off, right? But in this model, you might only lose, you know, a half a percent or a percent or whatever the number is overall, and you share that burden with everybody else. So I love that about this strategy.
I'll give you a couple of examples. I've talked to several mom and pop operators, and some of their business was down 80%. And when I started asking questions about, okay, wait a minute, why is it down 80%? Our portfolio is doing just fine. their majority of their locations, as is many of the mom and pop operators, are in restaurants and bars. Well, you know what happened, you know, in the early part of 2020. Now, we didn't fully escape, any of that negative side effect. We've got many locations in airports. Airports are typically a very good institutional grade location, not so much in, from March to June or July. But it does, to your point, it does diversify. When you get in that sort of situation and you invest in a fund rather than specific ATM locations, you really get to diversify.
So talk a little bit about kind of the investment. I know you have to be careful about talking about performance and all that. And oh, by the way, I don't know if I mentioned this, but Dave, you wrote a report for us when you were on our radio show. Just explain to people how the thing works. And I think I don't remember the name of the report, but it's all about investing in ATM machines and how that works. So rather than get into the weeds of that here, we want to talk specifically about the tax breaks. But if you're interested in getting that report, just send an email to ATM@realestateguysradio.com. ATM@realestateguysradio.com. We'll put the email address in the show notes below so you can understand a little bit about the pros, the cons, the risk. And of course, if someone decides to reach out to you and say, hey, I want to invest in this, you're going to give them a full offering memorandum and risks and disclosures and all the things that they have to have. So we're not trying to make an offering right now. We're just trying to make people aware that these types of investments exist and that if you can get this done by the end of a tax year, you can pick up a really big tax break and there's still a little bit of time left. So talk a little bit about, Dave, your particular thing in terms of, what's the minimum somebody could invest? Could they, what's the maximum? And in your knowledge, and again, you're not a CPA, we're not here to give tax advice, but just based on your understanding and people verifying this with their own tax advisor, if they were to bring in a certain amount of money, what kind of a tax break could they expect to receive? When do they have to have it in? And then a little bit about kind of how the investment is projected to perform going forward after the tax break.
Yeah, so what we do is we commit to a certain amount of transactions per month to the investor. And as you can imagine, there is some volatility in the fund. There's heavier tourist seasons, there's holidays, there's all that. But what we do is we take the volatility at the fund level and we say to an investor, look, we'll commit to you a certain amount of transactions per month and your portion of the surcharge revenue is we make that very clear as part of the offering as well. So an investor right now in this portfolio can get with $104,000 investment, they're going to be getting $2,184 per month, which is roughly a 25% cash on cash return. Now, before you get all excited about the 25% cash on cash return, that does not consider the fact that at the end of the cycle, at the end of the 7-year deal, you don't get that $104,000 back. So really the fair way to look at these numbers and compare them to, let's say, an apartment building or a self-storage facility or something like that, is you got to go with the IRR. The IRR,
internal rate of return.
Yep. It considers the tax impact, the cash flow, and the loss of value of your equipment at the end of 7 years. And that's around a 19% IRR.
Okay. Okay. So you put the 104,000 in, and you're going to get the $2,100, just call it $2,000 a month, keep it simple. And that's going to go on for 7 years. So 24,000 times seven is whatever it is. It's a number. And then you would deduct from that the 104 you put in because you're not going to get that back. The machines have been depleted. They've depreciated down to zero. They've worn out. You're going to throw them away. And so you're part of, I don't know, from a tax perspective, if you get a little bit back each month on principal or if it's just at the end, you just have the big write-off, I don't know. But at the end of the day, if you were trying to do the math just on your own in terms of the cash flow on what you put in, knowing you're not going to get the 104 back at the end, it's a cash flow investment. And what you're going to get instead of the cash back at the end is you're going to get a tax break at the beginning, aren't you? Is that how that works?
Yeah. And the cool thing about this is when you use the depreciation, when you use the 100% bonus depreciation on the front end, and you consider the first 12 months cash flow, you're getting like between 60 and 70% of your principal back in that first 12 months.
And right, because part of it is you're getting cash flow on operations, which I get, but the tax part is, and this bonus depreciation right now is something that's unique in the tax code right now. It used to be you had to spread the depreciation out over the life of the asset, but bonus or accelerated depreciation brings that all forward. So if you have other taxable income, and we want to talk about what kind of taxable income it qualifies for, right? Because like with real estate, not all your real estate write-offs are applicable to all of your types of income. So we'll find out in a minute how it works here. But you're going to put cash in, and then that year, when you file tax returns for that year, you're going to get refund back or a lowering of liability, so you send less money in. But either way, it's real money in your hand now, plus the cash flow coming in. So we've established kind of what the cash flow is coming in. We know that nothing comes in at the end. So, and of course, what you get in the beginning is going to be a factor of two things: what your tax rate is and which income it can help offset. So let's talk about the types of income. Like with real estate, you have to be either a full-time real estate investor. It only works against passive income. How does this work?
Okay, so the most conservative way, the worst way you can use this depreciation is just do nothing. Let it sit there, let it take out the tax liability on the income coming from the ATM cash flow. So that's like the most modest, most conservative, probably the worst way you can use it is just let it sit there and wipe out the taxable liability on that income. Now you got tax-free cash flow for the first 4 years. This depreciation will offset passive income. It'll offset the tax liability from passive income or
So if you have gains. Royalties, if you have rents, if you have something that goes on yep. your Schedule E, that would be passive income.
Correct. It also offset capital gains and depreciation recapture. So let's say you've got a passive investment in an apartment building. You sell the apartment building, you got a capital gains. It'll offset the tax liability on that capital gains, and it will offset the depreciation recapture from that sale as well. So you got kind of three different ways. You got passive income, capital gains, and depreciation recapture.
So if I was selling stock, which is appreciated and not inside a retirement account, but outside of a retirement account, and I sell a chunk of it, I'm going to have a capital gain, assuming that it's appreciated. If I get a capital gain on my stock, am I able to use the write-offs for this type of investment against that kind of a capital gain?
No, because that's considered ordinary income. Just another trick from Wall Street. They make it hard to protect that capital gain.
Gotcha. Even if you've held it more than a year. Okay.
Again, even if you've held it more than a year,
yes. You're not a CPA. We get that. So we want to continue yep. to remind people, don't hang your hat on any of this. These are ideas for you to take with your CPA. And as Dave mentioned, sometimes he ends up either educating or having his CPAs educate his investor CPA so everybody's on the same page. But you want to make sure that before you make an investment based on what you think the tax benefits are, that you validate that with somebody qualified to give you an opinion you can depend on. Okay. All right. And I cut you off, but you were getting ready to say something else.
I lost it, Russ.
I'm sorry, that's my fault.
I was so busy listening to you and that's okay. No, you're right on though. You're right on.
Okay. So then you talked about depreciation, capital gains on real estate. So if you were going to sell a piece of property, maybe a residence that you have where you exceed the threshold of capital gain exclusion, and you're going to pay some tax, or, you know, if you're in a real estate that you've already written off and you're not going to do a 1031 investment real estate, you're not going to do a 1031 and you're going to get hit with that depreciation recapture, you're saying this could help offset some of that.
Certainly can.
Okay.
And it's something that this is an asset that I use personally to control or mitigate my tax liability. I mean, I'm busy right now. I mean, we're talking back and forth with my CPA who's world class. You know, hey, what does my passive income look like? We've sold a couple apartment buildings this year. We've got passive income of X. What does that look like? How many ATMs am I going to need to purchase to offset that tax liability? So we're having those conversations right now.
Yeah. And I think that's what you have to do. But a lot of times those conversations are taking place in a vacuum because the CPAs know the tax code, but they don't know all the investment options or how creative entrepreneurs have put together investment opportunities to leverage the tax code. But if the CPA doesn't know, they can only deal in theory. And that's where you kind of have to have the two go together. It always comes down to where these disciplines have to be talking to each other. I know, Dave, you put a lot of time in working with your CPA, but also having your CPA educate your investors and their CPAs. So, okay, so you've got this deal, I think, as of this recording, currently available, and there's room. And you talked about 104. So is that a minimum? Is that a maximum? Is that just what a share size is? What's that look like?
$104,000 is the minimum, and I think the portfolio size is somewhere around $12 to $15 million.
Okay, and so we'll be almost everybody to take a big bite if they wanted to.
Yep, and we'll have that available until late December. I'm thinking December 27th or 28th.
Okay, so we're recording this just before Thanksgiving, so we're going to say this is maybe the next five weeks max. Yes. So again, if this is something you're interested in for tax year 2020, and you think that it might be appealing to you, then you want to kind of take a look at your balance sheet and see if you've got anything there that would be able to give you a taxable write-off. Of course, fund it. Sometimes you can borrow against an asset, like use a home equity line of credit or something on a piece of property that you have in order to free up the cash to make the thing happen. And then you can fund that loan with the cash flow, because these kind of cash flows will easily cover, right? If I took out a $100,000 loan on a piece of property and it cost me 4%, and I'm cash flowing $2,000 a month on $100,000, that's 24%. I'm actually making my equity in my property pay me 20%. Forget the tax break, right? Forget it. And of course, that's passive income. So the investment is, you're writing off part of that against that passive income going forward. So the point is, there's something here. And if you're the type of person that either has some idle equity on your balance sheet and some good borrowing power, or you've got some appreciated investments that you're thinking I'd like to reposition, or you're in the need of a tax break, or you just like the idea of 20%, internal rate of return, or 19% internal rate of return. Again, all projections, you have to look at the paperwork. Then this is something you probably want to take a look at. So request Dave's report at ATM at realestateguysradio.com. And when you do that, you'll get on Dave's list. And Dave will keep you up to date on anything that changes. But if you think this is something you want to act on quickly, we'll put a link to Dave's. Dave's a sponsor of the Real Estate Guys radio show. So we'll put a link down there to his page on our site, and you can connect with him there. And then just don't dawdle. I know it's holidays and you're thinking about turkey and football and Christmas shopping and holiday parties and whatever else is going on, but you've got a window of opportunity to reel in some tax breaks. So we've been talking about qualified retirement plan contributions, getting those the right kind set up. Certainly talking about some of these moves where you can harvest money and you may not even think you have, and get it positioned into something that will actually help you pay. And Dave, you've been doing this for a while, as I recall, right? How long have you been an ATM investor?
2012 is when I first started out in the ATM space.
Okay, so you've been at this for a good solid 8 years, so you're not a newbie. And I know you've done a lot of these. So, well, I really appreciate it. Any closing thoughts for the folks before we wind down here?
Yeah, to your point, when we started this in 2011, 2012, it was a close group of friends and family, and we were able to, run like that for the first kind of 2-3 years. And we've scaled up to the point now in the last couple of years where we're one of the top 5 ATM operators in the country.
It's awesome. Well, it's been fun to watch your trajectory. I know you're not done. And what I love best is that you're taking all the great things that you're learning and doing and relationships you've built, and you're sharing those with people who want to come along for the ride. And so keep up the good work. Look forward to keeping track of it. And I hope some folks out there that are in a position to take advantage of this, take a look at it, because it's actually one of the coolest investments out there. And I tell you, I never would have thought of it. So I love being around smart entrepreneurs like you that are turning over rocks, looking for these kinds of opportunities. Thanks for taking time today to share it with everybody, David.
Well, thank you, Ross. And I look forward to talking to your listeners about this.
All right. Take care. Thank you. Before you go, three things. Number one, subscribe. When you subscribe, you build up our subscription base, and that helps us reach more people. But even more important, it helps us attract great guests and subject matter experts to share their ideas and information with you. Number two, click that notification bell to make sure that when we do post a new video on this hot topic, you're notified right away. And number three, share. Please share this information with friends. Help them get on board this bus. Help them protect and preserve their wealth to take advantage of what's going on in the world today. All right. Thanks so much, and we'll see you in the next video.